Hi students, welcome to Structuring Lectures. Welcome to Limited Design of Steel Structures, conforming to IS 800-2007, the Indian Standard Code for the General Construction in Steel Code of Practice. Right? In the previous class, we have seen IS 1893-2016, Earthquake Loads, conforming to IS 1893-2016. Right? In today's class, we shall see the bolted connections, wherein we will discuss the types of bolts, the types of bolted joints, and failure modes of the bolted joints, and code of specifications pertaining to this. Right? Now, let us see the few photographs of the bolted connection, students. Then you will try to understand what we are trying to do. This is how we are trying to do a bolted connection. Right? Now I am showing a bolted connections, right, wherein this beam is connected to this column or stanchion by means of the bolts, right, and also you can see this bracing member, this inclined bracing member, is also connected by means of the bolts in two rows, right, through a gusset plate, as well as this beam is also connected to the flange of this column by means of the bolts in one row here, and also on the other side what is not seen is also another row, right? That is of the bolted connection, student. Right? Now let us also move to a further discussion, right? This is how we will see what are the bolted connections, and how the bolted connection should be designed, right? This is what the bolted connection, student, said, wherein we do have, first of all, the if I go to IS 800 old version, we do have only riveted connections like this. Now what I'm showing is a rivet, wherein a rivet consists of a head, right, which is in the form of a semicircle like this side, and even at the end, there will be a shape in the form of frustum of cone, so that after insertion into the members, now the blows are given by means of the hammer, so that it forms a head at the bottom, right? That is how the riveted connections as per the IS 800 old code. Now we do have right, this is how after applying applying the blows using the hammering, the head is formed at the other end, right, which in turn will connect these two parts, of the members which are trying to connect, right? Therefore now it makes almost perfectly 100% rigid connection, right? Now, whereas as per this IS 800 new version of 2007, we do have the bolted connections, right? Where now I'm showing a bolt here, like this, right? Therefore, which consists of a head, right? As well as the shank, or this is what called the shank part, or the body part, as well as it consists of the threading. Now you can see, right? That is a These are what called the threads, right? And also it consists of a washer, and also, right, bolt, which is either a hexagonal shape, or pentagonal shape as appropriate, as well as a nut at the other end, right? A nut along with washer, right? This is of the a bolt. Now what I am showing is a bolt, right? Now, here you do have the other connections as pinned connections, which are generally used in the mechanical hinges, as well as the other connections are welded connections. In today's class, we shall discuss the bolted connections, right? Now, however, the riveted connections are 100% rigid, but over a period of the time, due to fatigue, however, they may lose the fixity, and the disadvantage of these rivets is that they are made up of the mild steel. Therefore, they have lesser yield strength value of say hardly not more than 250 Newton per mm square. Therefore, more number of rivets are required for making connection. And also, the another disadvantage of this bolted connection is that not only more number of rivets are required, but red hot conditions of the steel is required during the hammering. Right now, just now we have seen here, right? Red hot, the bolt should be made red hot, and then only it should be inserted into the parts through which you want to make the connection. And the hammer blows should be given from the other end, right? Then, however, during application of these hammer blows, the rivets may fly away and fall in the vicinity, causing the damage to the people in the vicinity. Therefore, that risk will always be there. And however, another disadvantage is that the removal of these bolted connection is impossible, because once we have formed a riveted connection, means unless you do welding at the other side of the rivet, then only that head which is formed at the other side will be totally melted, then only it can be taken out of the joint. Therefore, they are almost 100% rigid. That is actually advantage. But if at all any modification need to be done, then here the modification alteration which you need to propose, they are difficult to be carried out at the site, right? Carried out at the site. And however, in order to overcome these disadvantages which are there in the rivets, we do generally provide the bolted connections like this, right? Bolted connections, right? Now let us examine the bolted connections, right? Generally the spanners are used for tightening these bolts, right? And almost now let us see what are the other connections also at a quicker pace before we discuss the bolted connections, right? And we do have the pinned connections. These generally pinned connections will permit rotations. Generally in the case of the bridge trusses, we do provide the pinned connections so that they will carry just only either compression or tension. However, in the bridges, we will not be designing them for the bending, right? Because if I want to design for the bending, then because their spans are very large, we require larger sectional areas or section modulus or moment of inertia, larger section modulus. Therefore, we will generally relieve the bending moments by providing the pins. That is the advantage of the pinned connections, right? However, a pin cylinder is inserted through that pin is inserted. Once this pin connection is made, it cannot be removed, right? Now almost it cannot be removed, right? That is also the advantage, right? And fourth one is the welded connection, right? However, we'll see that welded connection separately in the next topic, right? Now let us move to the photographs of the different bolts and bolted joints, right? Before we see these types of bolted joints, now let us see the schematic, students, right? Like this, right? These are the bolted connection what we are trying to discuss here, right? Therefore, we do have the, just now I discussed that if the bolt is tightened by the spanner, right? Therefore, it will apply a torque, giving rise to the clamping force between the two components. The clamping force between the two components, right? Like this, right? Therefore, then only it will hold the two different parts, right? At the other end, we do have the nut, right? Therefore, that right by holding that nut will rotate by the spanner at the to the bolt. Then it will tighten the parts which we are going to connect. They are what called clamped parts, right? Now let us see also this is what called nut and this is what called the bolt, shredded, and this is how the force in once we have this then obviously that this bolt is under tension, however the connected parts are under shear. Now let us see the schematic. That is of the bolt of diameter DW, and this is the washer just now shown, this washer, right? And where these are the connected members, total length of both put together, their depth is L actually, right? These are the connected members, and at the other end I do have the nut along with the washer, right? There is also another schematic. Let us see the other schematics at a quicker pace, student, right? Then you'll understand the right. This is how what I have just shown, just what I have shown, right? It is a bolt which is high strength friction grip bolt, right? This is high strength friction grip bolt, right? Made up of high strength steel, right? And next one is, this is the normal or black bolt, like this, normal or black bolt. What I've just shown is normal or black bolt, right? Now next one is the schematic of this. What are the different components, right? Means what are the different terminology of this bolt, right? Therefore this is what called the threading, right? The threading, and this is what the nut, right? Nut, as well as this is what called the body or shank, right? And this is what called the run out here in this bolt. What I am showing is not there, right? Therefore this is what called the run out, right? The intersection of this shank with that of this net threading part, right, is what called run out, right? And this is the radius of the bolt, and this is what the head, maybe the hexagonal or pentagonal or as appropriate. And however this length is what called the grip length, whereas this length is what called the thread length. Therefore total nominal length is equal to the summation of thread length plus grip length. Now like this, right? Now I'm just showing wherein I do have here this shank part, whereas this is now the thread length, right? Therefore shank as well as the thread length, right? Now also the nominal length, right? Now let us move to this we already see, student, right? Once we see this, let us move to the discussions wherein what are the types of the bolted joints. What are the types of bolted joints? Let us see, the joints are of two types, right? Either the joints are we are there in the types of the bolted joint, student. I hope you are understanding these discussions, right? These are the first type is the lap joints means wherein one member will be lapping over the other. This is what called the lap joint, right? Or the other type is the butt joint, wherein the two members will be butting, right, flushing one with the other, which are connected by means of the cover plate, like this. Then they are what called the butt joints, right? Therefore these are the two types of the bolted connections, wherein now we are there in the first lap joint, right? Therefore that is if at all one member is overlapping the other member like this, right, then this may be connected by means of a bolt like this, right? Connected means of a single bolt, right, like this. Therefore in such a case, this is what called a single bolted lap joint, right? Wherein this is in plan, it looks like this, right? Whereas in that row may be consisting of one or more than one number of rivets. Now let us examine this pictorially, right, like this, right? That is how a lap joint is shown in right. The bolts are in single row, whereas the bolts are in two row. This is what called the single riveted lap joint, the first one. This is what called the the single bolted lap joint. The second one is double bolted, means the bolts are provided in two rows. The bolts are provided in two rows, like this, in two rows, in 2 hours. Therefore, they are what called the double bolted, right? And that is how the tension is applied, the tension force is applied on the or the compression as appropriate, right? Then, however, now this is how the single bolted lap joint in plan in 3D view, and this is in plan that of the double bolted lap joint, right? And we would have the eccentricity in the lap joint, right? Therefore, however, that eccentricity will be taken care by what are the bending, additional bending moments that are there due to that will be taken care by the joint. Now let us examine that of the next, right? This is how just now we have seen the double bolted lap joint. We have also seen single bolted, means in single row, or double row, right? Or if at all three rows of the bolts are provided like this, right? First, second, or third, right? Then this is what called triple bolted lap joint, right? Then coming to that of the butt joint, just now I told that the plates will be flushing one with the other, wherein a cover plate will be provided, right? Wherein now we will try to connect by means of the bolts like this. Then they are what called, if at all only top cover plate is only provided, then is what called single cover plate butt joint, right? If at all even at the bottom there is a cover plate provided like this, then they are what called double cover plate, right? Now this is all, these are the main plate students, right? And at the top I do have a top cover plate, even at the bottom I do have a bottom cover plate which are connected by myself, a single row of the bolts. Therefore, this is what a double cover single bolted butt joint, or if I remove this bottom plate, then that will become a single cover single bolted butt joint if I remove this either bottom or that of the top cover plate. However, it looks in the plan like this, right? Now let's see the same in a schematic view is like this, right? Now this is what I'm showing, right? That is how in plan, however, that in single row means on either side of the joint one row will be there, right? This is what the main plate connected with main plate, this is a joint, right? Therefore, where I do have a cover plate on either side of this joint between the main plates, there will be a single row of the bolts provided. Then it is called double cover single bolted, or if only single cover is provided, then this is what called single bolted butt joint. However, in cross-sectional view it looks like this, right? The exaggerated view of this one, right? Then, and next one is the double bolted butt joint. I mean, now we'll provide in two rows like that. The third one is the double cover triple bolted, right? Like this, double cover triple bolted joints, right? If I provide in three rows, right? That is all the types of bolted joints are bolted connections, right? Bolted joints are bolted connection. This is how the lap joint, the bolt is there in single shear now, because here at the interface of these two plates, right, the bolt is there only in single shear, right? Whereas here for the butt joint, right, butt joint, for double riveted butt joint, we do have two shear planes, right? One shear plane at the intersection of the cover plate with that of the main plate, and also another shear plane at the interface of the bottom cover plate with that of the main plate. Therefore, this is how the bolts will be there in double shear. Therefore, they can fail at two two planes. That is over here as well as here, right? Whereas in the previous case, for the lap joint only, they were there in single shear, right? There is the single shear failure pattern as well as the double shear failure pattern. Now, once we examine this, let us move back to the further discussion set. Now, next subheading is the types of bolts. I hope, student, you are understanding the discussions, what we are having, right? Types of bolts. Just now, we have discussed that the first type of the bolts are what called the black bolts, or unfinished bolts, or ordinary bolts, or common bolts, or rough bolts, or bearing bolts, or generally they are called black bolts, right? Black bolts, right? Now, this is what I am showing, the black bolts, right? Now, however, they carry the forces by virtue of only shearing and bearing, or unfinished bolts, right? They will carry only by virtue of the bearing, or by virtue of the shearing as appropriate. Now, let us see, the next one is that of the high strength friction grip bolts, like this, right? High strength friction grip bolts, which are generally notated by HSFG, H for high, S for strength, F for friction, G for grip, high strength friction grip bolts, right? Now, let us see these discussions as per the product specifications, right? Now, just now we have seen the photographs of these both, right? High strength friction grip bolt as well as, right? This is a HSFG bolt, right? Whereas this is the black bolt, the unfinished or black bolt, right? Now, once you understand this, let us examine. Now, if I go to this page number of 13 of IS 1367. Now, let us move to IS 1367, student. I am there in IS 1367. This is what the code. Now, this is what that code IS 1367 part 3 2002, which is called the Indian standard technical supply conditions for threaded steel fasteners part 3. This is the part 3, students, right? Where this is giving the mechanical properties of fasteners made up of carbon steel and alloy steel bolts, screws and struts. Bolts, screws and struts, right? There, now we'll examine what it gives, right? Mechanical and physical properties, right? They are now given here, right? Now, we do have the nominal strength, tensile strength of these bolts, which is notated by Rm, Newton per mm square, or nominal, right? Therefore, we do have the minimum along the different grades of the bolts, like this, right? 3.6, 4.6, 5.6, right? Or 4.8, 5.8, 6.8, 8.8, 9.8, 10.9, 10.9, 12.9. These are the different grades of the bolts that are available. And even here, let us examine what is this 0.6 means, right? 0.6 means, that 0.6 means, right? It is the relation between the yield stress and the tensile stress, right? What it means is that this 0.6 means the ratio of the lower yield stress to that of the nominal tensile stress, expressed as a percentage, or it is the stress at 0.2% non-proportional elongation to that of the nominal tensile stress, expressed as a percentage, right? Therefore, 0.6 means 60%, 0.8 means 80%, 0.9 means 90%. Now, let us examine that, right? Where, now I'll move to the next continuation, wherein we have this property class given by 3.6, just now I already told 3.6, 4.6, 4.8, 5.6, 5.8, 6.8, 8.8, 9.8, 10.9, 10.9, 12.9. These are the different class of the bolts that are available, right? Or what is the chemical composition? What is the material and material treatment as well as the chemical composition? Limits, minimum, right? Now let us see that first one is that of, let us say, some 4.6. Therefore, in that 4.6 class bolt, the maximum carbon is 0.55, whereas maximum phosphorus is 0.05. Like that, maximum sulfur is 0.06, and as well as the maximum boron is 0.003, right? That is how, for each of this class, what are the chemical compositions, they are what given, right? Whereas if I go to 8.8, they are what called carbon steel with additives such as boron, manganese, etc., right, which are quenched and as well as tempered, right? Therefore, in such case, now let's see for 8.8, right, the maximum, the minimum carbon is 0.15, whereas the maximum is 0.4%, right? And the phosphorus is 0.035, and sulfur is also 0.035, whereas the boron is 0.003, whereas the tempering temperature is 425 degree centigrade minimum, 425 degree centigrade minimum. Like that, you see for other alloyed steel quenched and tempered 19.2, right? They are what called alloyed steel quenched and tempered, right? At quenched at temperature of 380 degrees. You please see this table, student, right? Now, next discussion is that of the mechanical and physical properties of the bolts and screws and studs, right? Now, this is how that mechanical and physical properties. The first one is the nominal tensile strength in terms of Newton per mole square or megapascals, right? For the different property classes varying from 3.6, 4.6, 4.8, 5.6, 5.8, 6.8, 8.8, right? 9.8, 10.9, 12, 12.9, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 10. And 8.8 itself is 2, right? Totally 12, right? Or 10, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 classes we do have. However, what is the nominal tensile strength in terms of Newton per mm square for 3.6? It is 300. This first, before that decimal, we do have 3. Therefore, that indicates that 3 multiplied by 100 as 300 is the nominal tensile strength. Then what is that 0.6? Just now we have seen the definition that 0.6 means the lower yield strength. Lower yield strength means that can be obtained as like this, right? 300 nominal strength multiplied by 0.6. 300 multiplied by 0.6 means 180, right? Like that, you can see for others, that, let us say 4.6 class, right? So for 400, even for 4.8 is 400, right? It's a minimum tensile strength, as well as the nominal tensile strength, right? Whereas nominal tensile strength is 4, whereas the minimum tensile strength for 4.8 grade is 420, right? Therefore, if I do have this, then 4.6 means 400 multiplied by 0.6, I do have the yield stress Fy is equal to 240. If it is 4.8 grade steel, student, then 0.8 multiplied by 400, that gives 320. Like that, you please see for others. Let us say the last one is 12.9 grade. 12.9 grade means 12 indicates 1200 Newton per mm square, whereas 0.9. Therefore, 1200 multiplied by 0.9, the yield stress is 1080 Newton per mm square. That is how the relation between the nominal tensile strength as well as the yield stress, nominal or ultimate tensile stress as well as the yield stress, Fu and Fy, in terms of Newton per mm square, right? Now, next one is the percentage elongation after fracture for 3.6 grade, 25, whereas this 4.6 grade percentage elongation minimum is after fracture is 22, whereas for 5.6 it is 20, whereas for 8.8 it is 12, whereas for 9.8 it is 10, for 10.9 it is 9, and as well as for 12.9 it is 8. That is how you just go through this table, student. We are there in IS 1367 part 3 2002, which deals with that of the discussions of that of the bolts, right? Now, next one is the minimum tensile strength, tensile loads and proof loads are also given. We do have now the different diameters are available. They are now notated by the M3 means 3 means 3 is the diameter, the diameter, right? The diameter M, right? M3, M3.5, M4, so on and so forth, M5, M6, M7, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 27, 30, 33, 36, 39. But generally, we'll be using from M5 to M36 by default. Therefore, what are their nominal stress areas, right? What is that nominal stress area? Let us say if I take that M27 means 459. Whereas if I take that of the M20 means 245 mm square. However, this is approximately 0.78 multiplied by pi by 4 multiplied by 20 square, means 0.78 multiplied by 314. Therefore, it is approximately 245. That is how we will get the nominal stress area or net area of each of these bolts from this table, 4.6 student, right? Like that, now even we can get the minimum ultimate tensile load for each of these property class, for each of these diameter of the bolts, they are not specified, right? Now, like that, the next one is that of the proof loads, right? What should be the proof load for each of these, right? Proof load is defined like this, right? Now, please see this, right? I'm not going through this, right? And next one is the minimum tensile load. Minimum tensile load. They're also specified. They're also specified here for different diameters of the bolts or different bolts. The different bolts. Now, next one. Next one is now even if I see, right, the bolts. If I see the bolts, generally the grade of the bolt will be shown on the bolt, right? That is how identification marks. This is a hexagonal and hexagonal head bolts. Now what I am showing is hexagonal bolt, right? Now you can see here 4.3 is seen. That indicates that this is 4.3 grade bolt, right? That is how, right? Whereas even we can see at the top, right? That is the trademark of that company, right? This is a trademark of the company, right? Rotated like this, right? XYZ, right? Whereas at the bottom, some 8.8. Here on this bolt, I do have 4.3. It is notated, right? It is given as 4.3. Even the trademark is like triangle, right? That is how on this hexagonal bolt, right? That is the example of marking on a hexagon and a hexalobular head bolts or screws, right? Now, once we examine the student, now let us move to the discussions. I hope you are understanding these discussions, right? Just now we have seen these grades of the bolts, right? Generally, this is 3.6, there onwards, right? They are what called the ordinary group bolts, right? You just now we have seen 3 means ultimate stress, or the tensile strength is equal to 300, and the relation, this 0.6 means yield stress is equal to 0.6 multiplied by this 300, 180, or if at all there is 330, 198 newton per mm square, right? 198 newton per mm square, right? That is how just now we have examined this. These are the different grades of the bolts. The ordinary black bolts are of the grades 3.6, 4.6 and 4.8 student, right? Their yield strength as well as the ultimate strength. Let us see for 3.6, right? The ultimate strength is 330, whereas the yield stress is 330 multiplied by 0.6. It is 180. Percent elongation is equal to 25. Just now we have seen from that coded specification. Like that, you please see for 3.6, 4.6 and 4.8 grades of the bolts, which are generally referred to as the ordinary black bolts, right? Next one is 5.6 and 5.8 and 6.8. These fall under the category of medium black bolts. And from 8.8, that itself is having the different diameters, right? The diameter is less than 16, and if the diameter is greater than 60 mm, then accordingly the specifications are quite different, right? And 9.8, 10.9, 12.9, right? Like that, they are all these four bolts, 8.8, 9.8, 10.9, and 12.9, they fall under the category of high strength friction grip bolts, like this, high strength friction grip bolts, right? Now, next one. However, if I see that last one, 12.9, we do have 12 means 1220. 1220 is the ultimate strength or tensile strength or nominal tensile strength, and 1220 multiplied by 0.9, it is 1100. 1100 is the yield stress, right? Yield stress, and the percentage, minimum percent elongation is equal to 8, right? These are the diameters of the bolts just now we examined. M5 to M36 are generally used, right? And the regular diameters of the bolts that we will be generally using in designs are M16, M20, M24, M30, right? this arrangement we already examined, right? We already examined, and even this we have seen. What is that area? Net area is approximately given by 0.78 AG, right? Where AG is the gross diameter of the shank area, right? Or shank area, right? Or gross diameter of the bolt, right? Therefore, which is given to pi by 4 d square, pi by 4 d square, where d is the diameter of the shank, diameter of the shank. Just now we have seen what is the shank, right? Therefore, net area is equal to 0.78 multiplied by AG, right? Even using the table, we have examined, right? Now, next one. And we can see that if the load to be transmitted is more, then number of bolts are generally obtained by the load to be carried by the connections divided by the bolt value. Bolt value is nothing but it is the force or the load resisted by one bolt, either in shearing criteria or bearing criteria, as appropriate for black bolts, right? Therefore, that is how the number of bolts can be obtained. Let us say, for example, if the force in the connection is equal to 300 kilonewton, therefore, and let us assume that the bolt value is equal to 48.5, then if I divide 300 with 48.5, now I'll get some 6 point odd value. Let us say to the nearest higher integer, you round off to the nearest highest integer. Even if you get 6.01, don't take that as 6, right? Say 7, right? Therefore, next integer value you take, right? That is how, as approximately 7, that is how you should round off, right? However, if I take the black bolts, then obviously I require more number of bolts like this. Let us say 7, 10 or more number of, right? Therefore, as the number of bolts increases, this is the disadvantage. This is the disadvantage of the black bolts, students, right? What's the disadvantage of the black bolts? Because their yield stress is less, or because their tensile stress is less. This is how the bolts and bolt categories. I think I just forgot. I'm just revisiting this. I'm there in IS 800 2007, student. I'm there in IS 800 2007. Even this table 1 of this IS 800 2007 British code of limited code of practice for the steel gives the tensile properties of the structural steel products. Where now we are seeing, just now we have seen, as per IS 1367 elaborately part 3, these different grades of the bolts 3.6, 4.6, 4.8, 5.6, dash up to 12.9. I have just opened IS 1367 and elaborately discussed this, right? Therefore, for this black bolts of 3.6 or 4.6 or 4.8, as the ultimate tensile strength is much less, 330 or 400 or 420 only, and their yield stress is less. Therefore, the number of bolts you require or we require after design is more. Therefore, this is a disadvantage of the black bolts. Therefore, as number of bolts increases, then more overlap is required, right? Once more overlap is required, then this is what called the overlap, student, right? Overlap, right? These are just small overlap, right? These are bigger overlap if I have to have the two or more than two number of rows. If I have to have, say, further three number of rows, then I have to have further the overlap. Overlap is increasing, right? Therefore, that is how it requires more overlap, and however, more number of couplets are also required in the case of butt joints, right? And whereas more overlap is required in the case of lap joint. However, the steel is only measured in terms of tonnage, right? Therefore, as these overlaps and more cover plates are increasing, then you require more weight of these steel parts. Therefore, tonnage of this steel increases. Obviously, it increases the cost. It will not achieve economy. Therefore, in such case, in order to overcome this, these disadvantage of normal black bolts, right, will generally use high strength friction grip bolts, right? Therefore, because they have higher yield stresses or higher tensile stresses, now I require only less number of bolts. Let us say here, If I use a higher HSFG bolt, let us say I may be having the bolt value as say some 112. Therefore, I just require 300 divided by 112. So approximately 3 bolts, 2.8 value, only 3 bolts. Instead of 7 bolts of that of the normal black bolts, I require just only 3 bolts. Now I am reducing the number of bolts by 4. Therefore, the cost of the bolts will also reduce as. Cost of the bolt also reduces, right? That is so. Less number of bolts are required, right? And the no failure. However, the another advantage of these Ayrton friction grip bolts is that obviously the Ayrton friction grip bolt means it is now let us see the definition as per this IS 800 student, right? What that is, it is a friction type connection, right? The connection affected by the pretensioned high strength bolts, where shear force transfer is due to mobilization of the friction between the connected plates due to clamping force developed at the interface of the connected plates by the bolt pretension, right? Therefore, these are friction type bolts. Therefore, only by virtue of the friction we do develop the force, we do develop force in between them, right? Therefore, because of that we don't have any shear failure or bearing failure. These failure criteria will be excluded. Now next one. And if this grip loses, then the transfer of the load will happen by virtue of the shear or bearing. In such a case, then it will act as if a normal black bolt. It will act as if a normal black bolt. However, in due course of time, we may be tightening at regular times using the spanners. Then that is how we need to maintain them, so as to act them as high strength friction grip bolts. Otherwise, the disadvantage of these HSFG bolts are that if they are not properly maintained from time to time, they will be acting as if just normal black bolts. Then they will be failing either in shear criteria or bearing criteria, right? If they will be failing in bearing criteria, shear criteria only, right? That is how the grip, if at all the grip is lost, then however they will fail only in this shear or bearing criteria. Therefore, the advantage of this HSFG bolt is that there is no stress concentration in the body or in the body part of this bolt. That is an advantage. However, in the case of normal bolts, there will be the stress concentrations at the intersection of these plates or that of the components one with the other. Their stress concentration will be there in the body of the bolts, right? Now next one. And the tension in the HSFG bolts is uniform, right? And as the less number of bolts are required, even the cost of the bolts is also reduces. However, the cost of the HSFG, each of these bolt is more than that of the normal black bolt. However, I require less number of bolts, therefore obviously the cost of these bolts will reduce, as well as the labor cost will also reduce. That is all. Let us also see this advantage of the HSFG bolts compared to that of the riveted bolts. However, in the case of the riveted connections, just now we have seen that these are permanent connections, right? The example for this one is where the rail tracks are generally provided by means of, in the olden days, rail tracks were used to be provided only by means of the rivets. Therefore, alterations cannot be done that easily. Until as I do welding and I remove the head from the other side and I melt the rivet part, I cannot remove this rivet. Therefore, there is no alterations will be done at a difficult means alterations will be making alterations will be a difficult job, whereas for this bolts are that of the high strength friction bolts. Normal bolts are high strength friction bolts. The alterations can be done very easily, right? Whereas the bolts, the in the case of the rivets, riveting process is very tedious and long time consuming. Whereas high strength friction grip bolts, right? Just you insert the bolt and tighten from the other side using the spanner. Therefore, your time consumed is very less. These are the other comparisons of the friction grip bolt with that of the or just normal bolt with that of the riveted connections also. Now let us examine the failures of these bolts at a quicker pace, student. Right? These are the failure patterns, right? These are the shear failure of the bolt, right? Therefore, the interface of these two plates, right? The bolt will be failing in the shear here. Right here, right in the shear criteria, right in the shear criteria, right now. However, once the tension force is applied, right, this tension force from one end to the other end is carried, right, by this body of this bolt by virtue of the shearing at this plane, right. Therefore, this is what called the shear plane. Therefore, this is now there in the single shear, right. That is how if this is a single shear for the lap joint students, right? Whereas if I see the double cover butt joint, therefore here we would have two weak planes, right? There is a one weak plane at the intersection of the top cover plate with that of the main plate, even another weak plane or shear plane at the intersection of the bottom cover plate with that of the main plate. Therefore, these are the two shear planes at which they will be there on the double shear like this, right? Therefore, these are the single shear as well as the double shear. I have just taken this, an exaggerated view is now shown, right? That is of the top cover plate, this is the main plate, this is what the bottom plate, right? Therefore, at the intersection of this top cover plate with that of the main plate, one weak plane, another weak plane at the bottom, right? Therefore, these are the two shear plane. This is now showing the exaggerated view of this shear failure mode of the bolt one, right? Like that. Now let us see the next one is that of the bearing failure of the bolts, right? Bearing failure means it is a failure of this bolt by virtue of the contact between the two surfaces, right? That is how the contact between the two surfaces. Now let us examine this, right? Now let us this, right? And right, a bolt, right, in the hole, right? Therefore, this is how in contact, right? This is how in contact, right? Therefore, this is what called the if at all the area in the contact is reducing, right, is reducing, then we'll say that the bearing area, right, is reducing. Therefore, at one point of time then the bolt will fail. Therefore, that is what called the bearing failure of the bolts, right? Bearing failure of the bolts, right? Therefore, that is how either it will fail due to reduction in the bolt cross section area for this top portion, or even here, right? That is how these are the bearing zones for the top plate as well as the bottom plate, right? Because tension force is applied here, therefore obviously this on the other side would have the bearing contact surface 0 to 180 degree, whereas for the bottom plate here, from 180 to 360 degree is the bearing contact area, right? They will be reducing in area. There is a this is what called the bearing failure of the bolts. Now let us see the next one. Whereas if the members are there in compression, we will be taking the gross area. If the members are there in tension, then we will be taking the net areas. Now, next one. However, if the tension capacity of the bolts is more than the shearing capacity, then the bolts will be failing in the shear criteria, right? Now, this is how the failure of the bolt in the bearing criteria, just now I have shown, right? Here, this is the bearing area 0 to 180 degree, it is a bearing area, 180 degree to 360 degree of that of the bolt, right? Because of that, a necking will form in the, right, or reduction in the shank or that of the net area, right? Because of which the bolt will fail in bearing. Bolt will fail in bearing, right? That is how now it is shown, right? It is shown with dotted line here. That indicates that they are in the bearing failure of the bolts, right? Now third failure is that of the bearing failure of the plate, right? However, if the shear strength of the bolt as well as that of the bearing strength of the bolt is much more than that of the bearing bearing strength of the plate or the tensile strength of the bearing, or if the thickness is less, right, then obviously what happens is the plate in the vicinity, because now the bolt is having more shearing area as well as the bearing area, obviously the bolt will not fail because the plate is of smaller thickness, obviously, right, at the whole location, right, slowly it will bulge, right, that is how the bulging of the plate will happen, right, leading to the bearing failure of the plate. I'll also show using another schematic, student, then you'll understand. Next one is the tension failure of the bolt, right? Now let us see this example, student, right? Now I do have a bolt connected between the two parts, right? If an eccentric load is applied, obviously these bolts will be there under tension, right? This bolt is there under tension, right? This bolt is also there under tension. Therefore, at one point, if this tension capacity of this bolt is more than that desired tension capacity of the bolt, then obviously that will fail in that tension criteria, right? Tension failure of the bolt, right? That is all. Now, this is what just now shown, right? I have shown this part, right? A beam is connected to the column, even at the starting of the discussion, right? At the bottom, I do have this seating angle, right? The seating angle is connected by means of these bolts, which are now subjected to, because of this eccentric loading, these bolts are under tension, right? This seating angle is now bulging like this, right? Therefore, these bolts are under tension, right? This seating angle, right? They are under now tension. Therefore, in such a case, the failure of the bolt is what called the tension failure of the bolt, right? Next one is that of the tension failure of the plate, right? Or sometimes this is called the tearing failure of the plate, right? Now let us see this, right? If I do have a lap joint like this, right? If the tension carrying capacity of the plate is less than that of the shearing capacity or that of the bearing capacity of the bolt, then obviously, or otherwise, if the plate is of thinner plate, right, or thinner plate is connected to the thicker plate as appropriate, out of these two, right, then the thinner plate will tear. It will break into two parts, right? Therefore, sometimes this is called the tension failure or tearing failure or splitting failure, like this, right? Just splitting failure. After splitting, you can see that, right? The plate is teared off into two parts at the bolted connection part, like this, right? It has just teared off, right? This is what called the tension failure of the plate. It happens because the tension capacity of this plate is much less than that of the shear capacity or that of the bearing capacity of the bolt. Last criteria is the block shear failure criteria, right? Now let us see this block shear failure criteria, student, like this, right? Let me go, right? This is all, right? This is what I was just showing, right? This is how the bearing contact surface, right? Therefore, that is how bearing failure of the bolts will happen, right? Or this is what the tension failure of the plate, tension failure of the plate, right? This is what the right, because of the less edge distance, this will shear off, the plate will shear off, right? Or like this, right? This is what called the block shear, right? It will shear off as well as subjected to tension, right? Or cleavage failure, right? Cleavage as well as the shear failure, right? That is all. Or this is how that bolt, right? This is how that bolt, that bearing contacts are faced, bearing contacts as well. Now let us see, this is how the different schematics, right? This is how the bearing failure of the bolt, right? Of the bolt, right? Or the net tension failure of the plate, right? Or this is how that shear out failure of the plate. Or this is a cleavage failure. This is of the shear out failure of the plate. Or this is a cleavage, means just the plate will just break into two parts, exactly, right? A cleavage, right? Whereas the shear out failure means from the bolt diameter onwards, the totally part will come out of that connection part, right? And next one is the cleavage and tension failure. This is cleavage as well as tension failure, right? This is what the bolt failure in shear criteria. Now next one, this is what the block shear failure criteria means. Not only cleavage as well as the shear, both, right? Not only tension, right? Because of this tension it will break. This is the gusset plate, student, right? This is what the connection which is made with two rows, 2 multiplied by 4, 8 number of bolts, right? Which is failing in tension as well as the shear, right? If this block shear failure is to be avoided, then we need to provide the minimum edge distance, minimum entry distance, as well as the pitch distance, as well as the gauge distances must be appropriate, like this, right? Therefore, this is how that it splits this connection. This connection is splitting not only along the gauge as well as it is splitting along the pitch also, right? Therefore, that is how the broken parts will be totally detached from the connections that of the plate. This is what called the block shear failure pattern, student. I hope, friend, you understood the discussions what we had in today's class. In today's class, we discussed the different types of the bolts and bolted connections, like this said, bolts and bolted connections, and the bolted failures and load transfer patterns, right? I hope, student, you enjoyed the discussions what we had in today's class, right? What we had in today's class, right? Then if you enjoyed the discussions, you try to click subscribe, like, share and comment over YouTube channel. We'll meet in the next class. Till then, bye bye, students.